We're going to be in the Gospel of John tonight. This will be our 64th exposition of this book. We're going to be in chapter 5, verses 28 and 29, a very significant text of Scripture. I draw your attention to the fact we're exposing ourselves to the words of Jesus. There are no more precise words and exact words than the words of Jesus. Now, as you know, Jesus is speaking to a crowd of people that have witnessed him healing a man, and they had thoughts about it. They weren't talking out loud, but they had thoughts about it, that this was done on the Sabbath day. And so he answered their thoughts, and it's kind of a long dialogue that he gave, and we're in the middle of that answer to these skeptics. So he's speaking to this crowd of people. He's doing so because they weren't aware of who he was. So far as they were concerned, he was Jesus of Nazareth. There were other people named Jesus. It was a common name. But he was not a common person. They knew he was a prolific teacher and a worker of miracles, but they really didn't know who he was. So he's opening up to them as much as they could receive who he really was. Now, in this answer that he has given, which began at verse 19, I just wanted to mention some things he said to them. He told them he could do nothing of himself. Well, if Jesus couldn't do anything of himself, I mean, what should we say? And he said, I do only what I see the Father doing. So he's operating by an unseen agenda. He said the Father loved the Son. These are what he told this crowd. The Father showed the Son what he was doing, what God was doing. The Father would show him greater things than this, than healing this man, that the people might marvel. As the Father raises up the dead and quickens them or makes them alive, so he gave the Son the ability to quicken or make alive whoever he wanted. And with the advent of Jesus, the Father judges no man. What is that? The Father judges no man. So he committed the judgment all to the Son. All men should honor the Son like they honor the Father. And he who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father. This is what he told the multitudes. I will draw your attention to this. He that hears the Son and believes on him who sent him has everlasting life. And the one who has everlasting life believes on him that sent Jesus, will not be condemned, but is passed from death unto life. He told him, the hour is coming when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God and shall live. Those were the dead spiritually. And then he said, the hour is coming when all that are in the graves are going to hear the voice of the Son of God and come forth. The Son has been given to have life in himself. That is, he can confer life. You have eternal life, but you can't confer it. God has no grandchildren. Everybody understands that? He only has sons, that's all. And the Father's given the Son the right to execute judgment. Now, this is a good example of how Jesus spoke to the people about himself. Now, observe, the subject was deity, not humanity. Interesting. There's a lot of what's said in the name of Christ that really has to do with humanity, not deity. That is not the way Jesus talked. Notice he placed the stress on what Jesus was given to do, not what men ought to do. The stress, and what about the stress? The emphasis was placed on what Jesus does, not what man ought to do. Notice that his word was stressed and his work was punctuated. This is the way now he talked to the multitudes. Now, you determine the answer for yourself. Is this what the multitudes are being told about Jesus today? You make up your own mind. I have my own ideas on it. The two persons that are underscored, the Father and the Son, and everyone else is like called the people, or they, or them, or all men, or the dead. But they're the two preeminent people. The two preeminent persons in the Bible are God and the Son. And God even takes the precedence. I shared with you before, when this first, I saw this, and I was astounded how I hadn't said much about God himself in my preaching. It astounded me. This is the perspective now, the glorified Christ. This is the kind of thing he's doing in heaven now. See, we're told now that Jesus is teaching his people now. The Ephesians, who never one time heard Jesus speak. Not one time, unless someone from Ephesus was in Jerusalem when he was there. Never heard Jesus speak. Yet Paul said to them in Ephesians 4:20, you have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him the truth as it is in Jesus. See? So Jesus is still teaching. John said he has come, the Son of God has come and has given us an understanding that we might know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in the Son, Jesus Christ. So Jesus is teaching the kind of things he said to this multitude, except it's even elaborated more. When you begin to see these things more clearly, it's not because you're so smart. It's because you've been taught. Amen. You've got to really see that. You've got to give God the glory for any increase in understanding. You got it from Christ. Amen. You didn't get it from man. You sure didn't dig it out for yourself. You did get some stuff on your own. I understand, but it was all surface stuff. It was all surface stuff. When you get down to the meat of the matter, that Jesus is the teacher. And I personally continue to be impressed how this knowing Christ according to what he teaches you, and I understand this all is correlated with Scripture. We're not saying that this is done independently of the Scripture, but if you take the Scripture away, you wouldn't have any idea what he was talking about anyway. The Bible's like your dictionary or your encyclopedia, but the teacher is Jesus, and he, of course, employs the Holy Spirit, too. All right, now here's our text, verses 28 and 29 of chapter 5. Marvel not at this, that is, that the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. That's speaking about salvation. Marvel not at this. Now, last Lord's Day, I said something about this, but I'm going to try to say it a little better tonight because it was still a little raw in my understanding. I want you to really see what this is talking about. Very important. Marvel not, my brethren, at these things that I told you. Some of the other versions say, don't be amazed at this, don't be astonished at this, don't be disturbed, don't be surprised, don't wonder at this. But when you tell people that there really is such a thing as a new birth, there's a whole lot of church people that are still amazed. They got to hire people to work out their personal problems. Well, I'm telling you the truth here. They went down to Egypt for help because they don't understand this. This is why people go to other people, from counselors to you name books to you name it. It's why they do that, because they don't understand this, that Jesus can make a person alive toward God, so the things of God aren't mysterious to you and your own person isn't mysterious to you. But these words still need to be understood. You remember when Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be more born again. Then he said, don't marvel not that I say unto thee, you must be born again. Don't marvel at that. Remember the time when Jesus stilled the winds and calmed the sea? And his disciples marveled. They marveled, saying, what manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? See, they marveled. 19 times in the Gospels, people are said to have marveled when they heard or saw what Jesus did, and it was never a plus. On the day of Pentecost, and people heard all people there heard their gospel in heard the mighty, wonderful works of God preached in their own language, they marveled. He took knowledge of them that they'd been with Jesus. When the scribes, Pharisees, and chief priests hauled Peter and John before them and told them not to preach in the name of Jesus anymore, and Peter gave this sterling defense of why he preached it, he wasn't going to stop, they marveled and took note of Peter and John. They'd been with Jesus. See, what they had witnessed was not something to which they were accustomed. These were like, we'd call them church people. These people were devout religious people. These weren't Sunday morning from 10 to 12 people. That's not the kind of people these were. These were people that spent, and the only time that people really got together was for a religious something. That's the only kind of feast they had. That's the only kind of holiday they had. See, their whole lives were governed by their relationship to God. God told them exactly how to live, what days to work on, what day not to work on, and so forth. But they weren't used. When they heard the apostles, this is not what they were accustomed to hearing. See, their traditions, as valuable as they might have seemed, did not prepare them for what Jesus came to give. Right, amen. Now, I'll say this as politely as I can say it. But I'm telling you, brethren, that what people are being taught today in the average church is not getting them ready for what Jesus does in people. They're not prepared to receive it. It just plain is over their head. And sounds too good to be true. That's the same. That's what caused the marveling. You see, it clashed with what they were used to. It was, whoa, this is way out of our league here. We've never come to the synagogue and saw anybody healed on a Sabbath day. That's never happened. We never heard someone speak with such authority.
Their traditions not assist them, they actually obstructed
them. That's right. That's right.
Say that later.
That's right. I can see this. I suffer from it myself. At the status quo of Christendom, there's a certain level if you're at, nobody will bother you.
Yeah.
But as soon as you start seeing something and doing something and saying something, there's a kind of an agitation. In the church, an agitation that takes place. Why? They're not used to that. They're not used to that. They're not used to someone who's on fire, whom the zeal of the house of the Lord has eaten them up. They're not accustomed to that kind of person who lives for the glory of God. Absolutely. See, they're not accustomed for that. That's what we're facing here. John wrote to believers, marvel not, brethren, if the world hates you. But if you live very long, you'll hear Christians complaining because people don't treat them good. Now complain about it. Yeah, well, just outright complain about it. Marvel not if the world hates you. Peter said to those who witnessed the healing of the lame man at the gate beautiful, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Why marvel? They'd never seen a lame man stand up and walk and leap and jump. They'd never seen that. He said, what do you marvel? Don't marvel at this like this is something we did by our own power. Jesus told an audience, his audience, the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself doeth, and he will show him greater works than these, that ye may marvel. The ministry of Christ was so different that the people that saw it stood aghast. They said, never seen anything like this. Now, if you're a believer in Christ, this is the kind of thing that you really long to see. I don't like average and mediocre. I don't like it. Particularly in any realm, I don't like it. Particularly in the realm of faith. Amen. And of salvation. Yes?
Yeah, I was thinking this marveling gives place for unbelief.
That's right.
And when you marvel not, then that's a way that you are a helper of one another's faith.
That's right. Marvel not. Now, when you got to the point where you're not marveling, you begin to become accustomed to kingdom manners. Like the disciples, we have an example of this. We have the disciples, they were with Jesus 3 years. They got accustomed to the way he talked, the way he worked, and so forth. After he rose from the dead, they still had a little bit of trouble. They went, Peter said, I'm going back to fish. I'm fishing. And they said, some of the others said, well, we'll go with you and fish too. So they're fishing. They'd already seen the glorified Christ once. This will be the second time they saw him. And Jesus is on the shore and he calls out to them. He says, children, have you got any meat out there? Did you catch anything yet? They shouted back, no. They've been fishing all night. And Jesus said, cast the net on the right side of the ship that ye may find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it in for the multitude of fishes. All right, now, John, he'd been with Jesus for 3 years. He looks at Peter, he says, it's the Lord.
Yeah,
see? He didn't say he marveled, he said, it's the Lord. See, that's what not marveling. You can't make yourself not marvel, I understand this. But you got to stay in the marveling territory, stay there. Pretty soon you'll get accustomed to this and you'll say, it's the Lord, and you'll have a more comely response. Yes.
It's like everybody prayed for a brother to get well, and then and he's instantly healed, and everyone marvels. What does that say about your faith to begin with?
That's
God,
right.
That he could heal that brother.
Yeah. See, if you stick around, those where that kind of thing happens, it won't be long, you'll stop marveling.
Been thinking, and it seems to me like there are two kinds of marveling. There's this marvel not that Jesus was telling them in the sense of being negative, as being surprised because they're not accustomed to what the Lord is doing. But it seems like there's a positive side to marveling as well. Psalm 118 says, this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And this is the day which the Lord hath made, and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. So Jesus did say, marvel not. So there is a state you can be in which you're not surprised of what the Lord has done, but it doesn't stop you from accrediting him with his wonderful works. Because they're wonderful works.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're worth considering.
Yeah.
And they're worth our giving praise to. Because God is the one who has done it. That kind of marvel, I think, should be encouraged. And this marvel not has to do with unbelief. People even say that. I can't believe it.
It also has to do with an old covenant. This kind of thing isn't said under the new covenant. See, there was a marvel because there had not been much done in comparison to what's done in Christ. The wonderful works of God were nothing except what happened on earth. There were no promises given to Israel except what happened on earth. There was no advantage except fleshly advantage. All the miracles were right down here where people could see them. That's where they all were. And in that kind of condition, they praised God for his... Read the text again.
This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And this is the day...
We'll
rejoice and be glad.
It's the work that was marvelous. It's the work that was marvelous. And they that's what they saw. I distinguish between that and marveling at. You see what I mean? The work.
I like the word all. For the new covenant? Yeah,
all.
The old covenant. In the new covenant, we marvel not, but we are in awe.
Yeah.
So we affirm the majesty, the power, the transcendence of the Lord.
Yeah,
it's just awesome.
And even so, that... Even that is introductory. That is introductory. The only time that happens is when there's something that you're not accustomed to, like an angel appearing to John and if he fell down. It wasn't everyday stuff. Now what I'm talking about tonight is when we are in the presence of what God is doing. When you're a face, if I can tell you right now, I don't care how close you are to Christ. If Gabriel stood up before you, you'd faint dead away. Because this is not the kind of realm, kind of realm you're living in. Not even John was in that kind of realm. So he's stricken because of it. Daniel, same thing. He lost all his strength. The angel had to raise him up, give him some strength. Because it was higher than where he was at. And he wasn't down in the low zone. That's not what it was. Same thing with these marvelous works. They were higher than where the people were living. That's why they marveled. As John, he depicted what a person does when he's living and walking in the glory. It is the Lord. Now, this is something I had to be careful in even talking about because we can't leave the impression that the things God does are normal. What I'm seeking to establish is when you live in the glory, you're not taken back by what you see and hear. That's what I'm saying here.
And to progress and to move forward.
Yeah. It does. I mean, even the person, it is the Lord. I mean, that was not a casual casual statement when John said that. But he knew what was happening. Yes.
Usually in the case of marveling, it happens when a person didn't expect the thing to happen. Like you weren't looking for that. Or it was like an out of the ordinary kind of experience. Like it wasn't something you'd even look for. We don't, that's kind of what we're seeing as we grow. We don't get to this point where we're like, we're never looking for these things to happen, so they do. It's just like a surprise. We actually come to anticipate and expect God to work, where it's not like strange anymore.
See, God receives glory when you understand.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
That the vain man glory, let him glory in this, that he knows me and understands me, that I am the Lord, for in these things I delight, saith the Lord. That's what we're talking about. Yes, Sister Bart.
The other side of the coin that's been brought up tonight, that because we're in the world and we're in a body, there are still going to be things that we can't fathom that the Lord does. He's able to do abundantly above all that we could ask or think.
Yeah.
And so in this respect, whenever the Lord does such a work that we didn't know to ask for, or that we didn't conceive or imagine, then he does that, instead of a marveling as in it's strange and unfamiliar, you find a quick agreement with it.
That's right.
Because it's from the Lord, and we have been in his presence, and so it's like nature.
That's right.
Amen.
Now here's why I said I'm going to try to approach this with great care in view of what Sister Barb said. When God works in this manner that is over and above, It's in order that we might become acquainted with that type of thing. You might become acquainted with how God works. So actually, when this begins, and then you come to a stage where what God does is really higher than you had expected. But if you had not become accustomed to the lower things, it would have completely thrown you out of kilter, like it did the people that rejected Jesus. See, that's what I'm saying, that the purpose for God working in a manner that not only is above but classes is to get you accustomed to the work of God. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, I think Jesus is reasoning here something like this. He's saying, in the previous verse, it says he's given him authority to execute judgment because he's the Son of Man. Mm-hmm. Then he says in verse 28, don't marvel at this. Then he goes on to say something that's even greater,
That's
than
exactly
what he just said.
Yes,
so
exactly
so the reasoning here is, if you don't believe what I just said, you're not going to believe what I'm saying now.
That's it.
So it's a marveling that's based on a person who is not there. If you're marveling, it's because you're not listening and believing what I just said about myself.
That's
right. Seems to be the sense of it.
When you marvel properly, you come up to the level that was made known at this particular work. You come up to that level, but then there's a higher, as he's going to demonstrate in this text tonight. He's going to demonstrate something that's greater even than what he said. Remember, you have another example of this, Isaiah. Isaiah, he saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Remember, Isaiah 6, some way transported into the heavenly realms. Saw the Lord high and lifted up, and while he's up there, he was stricken with a clash of this environment with himself. He says, I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amidst a people of unclean lips. And then a command is given from the throne to get a hot coal to lay on his tongue. He says, now you've been purged from your iniquity. Now he's come up to this level up here where he can respond differently. And he hears a discussion going on, and the Lord says, whom will I send? Who will go for us? Isaiah doesn't marvel because he hears this. He says, here am I, send me. See, he became accustomed to this realm. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, just to build on this a little more to make it pertinent for us, if our faith now is deficient, like if what we know now, what we've heard now, what's been revealed to us now, if we haven't received it, we haven't believed it, we haven't applied it, even if God were to do something more, we wouldn't recognize it, we wouldn't receive
it,
therefore, in that situation, God probably wouldn't do anything with people who are in that condition.
Yeah. That's exactly it. That's what I tried to accent Sunday. I was a little bit too clumsy to suit me in it, but that's why that is. When you've got to have this spirit that says, I'm not content to be in a state of consternation. Yes, Brother Matthew.
I was reminded, in contrast to this kind of environment where we're surprised when people have a favorable response to the gospel, to the Galatians, Paul wrote, I marvel that you're so soon removed from him.
Yeah.
They call it the gospel of Christ.
Mm-hmm. See, that was at variance with the nature of spiritual life.
Yeah.
All right, now Jesus, he says, marvel not at this. Judgment's given to the Son, who he quickens whom he will. Those that are dead will hear his voice and be raised from spiritual death. Don't marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice. Now, the resurrection he was speaking about in verse 25 is being raised from death and trespasses and sins, but that resurrection is discretionary. Everybody that's dead in trespasses and sins aren't raised, right? It's discretionary. Only those he quickens. But this resurrection is going to mention is not discretionary. Everybody's going to participate in this, see? So don't, if you think it's something when I raise whom I will, and I don't raise whom I don't, there's the resurrection where I'm going to raise everybody. The hour's coming. That's not an hour like 12 noon. That's an appointed time. This is appointment language. Now, I want to mention some of these to show you that God has designated when certain things happen. Now, you can't take this to he appointed everything that takes place. Don't make the mistake of doing that, like the man that was during a bad winter storm. He believed that everything that happened was appointed. And so he was in a second-story apartment, and he slipped on some ice and fell down 15 steps to the bottom. He landed. He said, "Thank God that's over." You don't want to live like that. We're on a higher level than that, thinking, well, God must have meant for that to be. Maybe he did, but don't assume that. When you think about what God intended, think about these hour cometh sayings. Daniel gives a prophecy. He gave a prophecy. Until the Ancient of Days came, he's speaking about the Messiah in this 7th chapter through verse 25. And judgment was given to the saints of the Most High, and the time came, when the saints possessed the kingdom. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. The time, it's the appointed time. Jesus said to the woman at the well, "The hour cometh and now is." Remember, my point is that God appoints these hours. Amen. "When the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him." Comes the Last Supper on the eve when Christ was going to be betrayed. "When the hour was come, he sat down with the 12 apostles with him, said unto them, with desire, I have desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." See, a time, an appointed time had come for this. Christ's betrayal. "Then cometh he to his disciples and saith unto them, sleep on now, take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners." See, he lived close enough to God, he could pick up on the times. Of old time, the children of Issachar, they knew the times and what people should do, right? It goes in Isaiah 25. There, if you live close enough to God, you will pick up on when something's about to happen. I'm talking about significant. I'm not talking about incidental things. "When Jesus was left alone," Isaiah said, "he'd tread the winepress alone. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, now is, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. Yet I'm not alone, because the Father's with me." See, he'd never been to that moment, he'd never been alone. He was raised up, he wasn't alone. Mary and Joseph was there, brothers and sisters were there. With his disciples, they were with him, but when he come down to die, he had to do it alone. And because he did it alone, you don't have to do it alone. And one other, when the hour of judgment, Revelation 14:7, the angel said with a loud voice, "Fear God, give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come." See? It's appointed, right? Unto man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. So these are divine appointments. This is the time, the hour is the time when God's going to do what he had determined to do. Now, Scripture indicates to us that his determinations, so far as his eternal purpose are concerned, were made before the world began. Just like the temple was, they didn't start the building on the temple until all the stones and timbers were prepared. They had the blueprint for it. Before they started shaping out the timbers and the stones, there's a blueprint, a pattern that God gave David, David gave Solomon. That was determined before the building ever started. Now, what God's doing in Christ was determined before this thing ever started.
Amen.
You got to see that now. Amen. Jesus saw it, and he operated. That's why he said, I only do what the Father tells me to do, because the Father's following this eternal purpose. So the world was created and populated and is strictly governed by God only after the determinations had been made.
All of God's works are finished
from the foundation. Yeah, that's exactly it. The building wasn't done, but what was going to be used to do the building, that was already set in stone. Now, some people have some trouble with this, I understand, but so just let them have trouble with it. That's the way it is. Human wisdom does have a lot of difficulty with this.
Yeah.
Now, here's what's going to happen at this appointed hour, this pinpoint time. All that are in the graves. Now, remember, in verse 25 and 27, he's speaking of all that were in the spiritual graves, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Now he's speaking of the resurrection of all the dead. Now, there's a lot of confusion in the Christian community on this subject. And there should not be. No man of God should stand back from this subject. And I've heard preachers, too many preachers, admit that they don't want to get involved in this because they don't understand it. Well, they should really quit preaching. Because the early preachers preached the resurrection of the dead.
Amen.
That's what they preached. All that are in the graves, all of them, John saw that in his vision on Patmos, when the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell were delivered up the dead which were in them, they judged every man according to his works. Death, in this case, is the grave where the body is. Hell, or that's old English, Hades, the unseen abode. The spirits were in Hades, and the bodies were in the grave. The graves gave up the bodies, and the spirits entered into the bodies. That constituted the resurrection. A resurrected body without a spirit equals zombie, I guess. But death and hell gave up the dead, see, in them, both in them. One time. Now, the scriptures do speak of a first resurrection. I understand that. But it never speaks of a second resurrection. Never. First resurrection means it's a different kind of resurrection. It's not a bodily resurrection. There's a resurrection of the dead. Always in the singular. Never in the plural. Never. The Bible doesn't speak of resurrections. A lot of theologies do. Saints are raised, 1,000 years past, sinners are raised. That is a conclusion. That's not apostolic doctrine. That's a human conclusion. And Jesus said, the hour, not ours, the hour is coming when all that are in the graves will hear the voice of the Son of Man. Well, it couldn't be any plainer, can it, really, than that? See, the unseen part of man departs from the body. Departs. Said of Rachel, as he was dying, it said Rebecca, I think it was, as her soul was departing, left her. So it goes to its abode, the body goes to its abode, but the resurrection, both give up and they unite. There'll be no spiritless bodies there, or no spirits without bodies. None at all.
All right. I have a question for you.
Go on from this. There is no... The apostles and prophets don't speak of a second resurrection.
Yeah.
So why would they... Why does the Spirit speak of a first resurrection?
It's a different order. It's a different kind of resurrection. It's the same reason as the first covenant. It's a different kind of covenant. First... See, it's a different kind. The first man, he was a different kind of man. He was flesh and blood man, but he was a created flesh and blood man. So there's a, first been is a different order. Now, John, I'll deal with that a little bit later. This language is designed to teach us and acquaint us with the fact that death has been imposed on all humanity. Nobody's excluded from it. I know it says the soul that sinneth it shall die. But of course that's every soul. Because there's no one that doesn't sin, hasn't sinned. Death has been imposed, and the hour came when this consignment to death will be reversed. It looks now like death is the last word. That's how it looks now. It looks like death is the last word. It's not the last word. Jesus is going to speak the last word. And he's going to undo death. And death itself is going to die. Death and hell will be cast in the lake of fire. There isn't going to be any abode. There is not going to be an abode for the dead. Because there won't be any dead.
That's right.
Some will be living under God in the presence of the Lord, and some will be just existing. Be what they'll be doing. They're all going to hear his voice and come forth. See, that's why Jesus, when he raised Lazarus, he said, Lazarus, come forth. If he hadn't said Lazarus, the graves would be emptied out. That's how potent his voice is. That's how potent it is. He's going to be a shout. He's going to shout the dead out of the grave. It's up to all of them. And they shall come forth. Now here, God calls some people to come to Jesus, calls some people to come to him. Some come, some don't. All right? But not going to be some will and some won't on this. All are going to come forth. Single resurrection, all that in the graves. Remember, there's a resurrection spoken of in Revelation. The first resurrection. It's called first resurrection. And some people say that's a new birth, but it's not the new birth. He tells you what it is. It's not the new birth. We don't really know very much about it, so we just have to just take what it says and work with that. And what it says is that. It's a time of universal like revival and quickening that happens, and Satan's bound in the bottomless pit, so he can't do his will for a season. And it says the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, that's who was raised. So it says they were raised and they would reign with Christ 1,000 years. I have my own idea about what this is, but this isn't speaking about all the saints being raised from the dead. It's speaking of these souls that will be healed. They come back to life, and over them the second death has no power, he said, had no power. This can't be just a new birth, because that would mean that falling away was impossible. So this first, the first resurrection of Revelation 20, it's in some way these martyrs are going to resurface, either in somebody else or I don't know. It doesn't give you all the particulars. But what they died for is going to resurface and dominate the world. That's going to happen. And the people that have adopted the wrong cause, they're told things going to perish. It's going to fade away. That's the extent of what we know about the first resurrection. But it's called first because it's different. Now it says, they shall all come forth, they that have done good. Now, it's interesting, isn't it? He didn't say they that have believed. Isn't that interesting? He didn't say they that are in Christ. He said they that have done good. That's what he said now. Not talk good, done good. Well, we do understand that God's people are to do good, lay up for themselves a foundation of good works. As a matter of fact, those that are in Christ are the workmanship of God, created to do good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. See, doing good is the proof you've been born again.
Amen.
That's what people that are born again do. Yeah, we don't see that well, and you're seeing people that aren't born again. That's what, in fact, that's why they were born again. So they could do good. That's why. And everybody that does good, God's going to honor. We're raised to walk in newness of life. That is, to live in the expression of this new life. Now, if that actually was taking place in a visible sort of way, it would put an enormous amount of religious people out of work. If people just lived in newness of life. They lived unto God. They presented their bodies a living sacrifice to God. You'd be surprised how many employees the church has to deal with this people walking disorderly. You'll be surprised how many they are. They're the burden of the church staff. Serious stuff, very serious. Now, while we're in the world, we're alive unto God, but we're in a body that's dead. If Christ is in you, Romans 8:10 says, if Christ is in you, the body is dead. I mean, you got to make it do what's to be done. Or as Paul would say, keep under your body. You got to keep on, you carry it, it doesn't carry you. But that's not going to be the case when they that have done good come forth at the shout of God. These new bodies they have, they're going to be in perfect accord with their spirits. Be perfect accord with it. Now, see, you got to grapple with your body. You got to wrestle with it. You have to deny it. You have to reject its pleas. It's trying to get off the cross, see? But it's not going to be that way in the resurrection. They're going to come forth. They're going to be perfectly compatible. That's what this life is all about. It's about getting you ready to enter that resurrection body.
Amen.
Now, for those that are ready, that will be glory.
Yeah, amen.
For those that aren't, it will be hell. You're going to have people whose spirits have been cultured for the things of the world.
Yeah.
That's what they want. That's what they love. The things of God they hate, and they're going to be anybody that cannot carry out one desire that they have, not a single solitary one. That's the ultimate entrapment. You've got a wayward soul in a body that won't let that soul express itself. Just the reverse of what we experience in Christ, just the reverse. Raised to newness of life. Now, while we're in this world, 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians 4, 10 and 11 tells us that we bear about in our body the dying of Jesus and the living of Jesus. They're made manifest, the dying of Jesus and the living of Jesus, huh? In our mortal flesh. He gets right down to it. That's marvelous to see. You are walking, if you're living by faith, you're a walking testimony of what the death of Christ means and what the life of Christ means. Your body is the vehicle to show Christ's death. Your spirit's the vehicle to show Christ's life. See? When you come forth from the dead, it's going to be glorious for those that are in Christ. They that have done evil, they're called children of disobedience in Scripture. They were vassals of Satan. Satan worked to them to do whatever he wanted. They're going to be raised, and it's called the resurrection of damnation. The resurrection of damnation. If you live for Christ, you are going to be raised from the dead. Make no mistake about this. You are going to be raised from the dead. But if you live for Christ, when you're raised from the dead, it'll be to salvation in its fullest sense of the word. Satisfaction, fullest sense of the word. Joy unspeakable and full of glory, fullest sense of the word. The person who isn't, it'll be the worst experience they ever had, and it'll never end. It'll only grow worse. While the state of the righteous will grow better. The resurrection of damnation, it's just strong language, isn't it? The word damnation means separating or asundering. In other words, God is going to withdraw in every sense from these people. They're going to be in a lake of fire where there is no good, no God, no comfort, no satisfaction, no pleasure, none at all, not even a second. None of it. Now, let me tell you, it's worth living for God just to stay out of there. Amen. If you can't take any other reason, that's good enough to get started. That'll get you started. That'll get you started. Because those that done evil, you know some people done evil, don't you? Well, I once did evil. This is where they're going to be. If they don't change, this is what's going to happen to them. And I think they need to be told. Somebody told me. And I finally believed it and got out of that. It needs to be told. You don't always have to just talk to seeker friendly. Talk to people that are on their way to hell. Talk to them. On their way to hell and don't know it. Somebody's got to tell them. Somebody's got to tell them. They'll be punished. They'll be tormented. And to add to this dilemma of total dissatisfaction, they're going to be, this is Revelation 14:10, tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. They're going to see what they missed, and they still aren't going to want it. Understand it, the damned, they don't want to be in heaven either. Remember that rich man saw Lazarus, or he didn't say, Abraham, how about me coming over there? Instead, he asked for Abraham to send Lazarus where he was at. See, if you don't have an appetite for Christ here, you will never have it in all eternity. You will never one second have a craving for Christ.
Amen.
Yes.
I've heard it said regarding that in the presence of the Lamb, it's everything they love gone with everything they hate in front of them also.
That's right. See, if God was repulsive to them in an introductory state while they were in the world, then they'll really be repelled by him when they see it in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. People have wondered, are we going to see them? Well, I have my doubts that we'll see them. We lived a life with them. I don't think we'll. But the idea is what they will see,
yeah.
not what personalities in heaven will see, but what they will see, what they will see. So the torment of hell plus that's going to be this is a torment for them. This is going to be torment for them. You know yourself, if you come across someone that is an unusually wicked person, and you start talking to them about the Lord. They don't smile. They despise this. I'm talking about people that are really down in the gutter type people. They don't want to hear that. But you can imagine when you're faced with the glory of holy angels and the Lamb, and you see it, and you're reminded of how opposed you were and still are. Just their wrath, the anger and disappointment and so forth of the damned will increase, but they'll never, like, become mad or lunatic or crazy. Eh? They're going to be in full possession of their senses. Eh? And it's, the worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. That's what it's talking about. It's talking about this gnawing conscience. See? Well, I won't dwell any more on that, but that Jesus told that to the multitudes. Yes, Brother Jason.
Yeah, you know, when Jesus mentioned this resurrection here to these people, he was speaking to Jews.
That's right.
And that's right. If Jesus came back today and were speaking to religious people today, and he mentioned the resurrection of the dead, there'd be a lot of people who wouldn't know what that is. Yes. But the Jews did.
They knew, yes.
These people knew what he was talking about. It's mentioned in Daniel.
Yes, amen.
And the Jews had this hope,
yes,
of the resurrection of the dead. That was one of the differences between the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
That's right.
The Pharisees believed in the resurrection, the Sadducees didn't. And remember when Lazarus died and he was talking to Martha there, he said, Martha, your brother will rise again. She said, I know he will at the resurrection.
That's right.
These people knew about this. But what Jesus is saying here is that the authority to raise the dead has been given to him.
Amen.
Now, after Jesus was raised in the book of Acts, when the apostles began to preach, they preached the resurrection of the dead. In Jesus.
That's right.
That's what the book of Acts says.
That's right.
In other words, Jesus is the first to rise from the dead. He's
Amen.
The first fruits of the dead. Now, you said a minute ago, this isn't being preached. That's bad, because this is central.
Amen.
Yes, it is.
That's what they
is.
Preached. This is this is the gospel. This is Christianity.
Yeah.
So if that's not being preached, that's bad.
Remember Paul said, concerning the hope of the resurrection,
Amen.
I've been called into question. They preach through Jesus the resurrection of the dead. Yes.
These particular words about the revelation, the resurrection, were revelatory. Just like when Jesus said, answered the question about whose wife shall this woman be, having been married to seven brothers.
Yeah.
They say, there won't be any marriage on it. No man could have known these things.
That's right.
Only the one who came
from
the Father could know these things.
Amen.
And declare these things to us.
Amen.
And we'll underscore once again the importance of knowing what Jesus said. Exposing yourself to the words of Jesus. There's probably more of them than you think. I've got a little booklet. They don't publish it anymore, but it was all the sayings of Jesus. It's a booklet about 3/8 of an inch thick. All the sayings of Jesus, and they're in chronological order, and all the texts, and it's just pure text. That's all it is. But I looked at, wondered if someone had thought to republish that, not publish. No one's published anything like it. They ain't interesting, but it's very good just to sit down just to read them. It has an index, what the occasions were and so forth. All right. Yes, sir, Brother Aaron?
Jesus said, also told Nicodemus to marvel not about the new birth. Is this something that Nicodemus should have been able to receive? Because of things that that were established and taught in the scriptures. He says, thou art a master of Israel. You should have known these things.
Yeah.
So, you know, I would be somewhat offended if my wife just marveled that I went to work.
That's right.
Because that's just kind of expected. But I'm not offended that she expects me to.
Yeah, amen. That's good.
She knows me and understands, and that's just kind of how things work. So the marvel not has to do with somebody that is far enough from God that they're shocked by what God
does. That's it. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. And everybody can see that the longer you live in the presence of God, the less shock there is, and the more rejoicing, and you move into the territory. What has happened when there's something worthy of marveling? It's like a stepped up a territory, a notch, and now you got to get up into that to that area, and then there'll be some more come. Yeah. Brother Justin.
Refreshing to be able to be with the saints so that you can actually speak about these things because you can't speak out in the world
about it
because they don't really understand.
Right.
They will marvel, so you really can't talk about it.
It's refreshing, isn't it? When you, it refreshes the soul. Yeah. How about Justin?
I remember when, I'm trying to think of when it was, it says Jesus marveled at.
Talk up.
Unbelief.
Yeah, Jesus marveled at their unbelief. Unbelief, it has that effect on someone that's high up, then the opposite effect.
Yeah, well, their unbelief was extraordinary unbelief. Like the mighty marvel at the faith of a man, it was extraordinary faith. I think we're living in a time when there is extraordinary unbelief. Yeah. All right, and we'll have Sister Barb come forward.